no God, no country, and no people. What do you do with broken times? Do you get mad? Some people do that. They get mad and they want to blame everybody else. Why are we acting like this? It's somebody else's fault. And a lot of times it's really our own, because we didn't take care of things soon enough or something like that. And so you just try to forget it. You just try to ignore it and say, well, it'll get better someday. And so we hope things will be better. You see, what Jesus did is he tries to deal with the real issue. He tries to deal with the real problem. You see, God had made a promise to Abraham and to his seed that he was going to bless all families in the earth. Well, that's great. He's going to bless all families in the earth, and he's going to do it through Abraham and through one of his descendants. And then there's, you know, Isaac and Jacob that comes along, and then the 12 sons, and there's all of these people. And it's going to be one of his descendants. We don't really know which one. But then God starts blessing those 12 sons of Jacob, and they find themselves in captivity in Egypt, and he brings a whole nation out, brings them across, feeds them, gives them clothes, all this, and makes sure their clothes don't wear out. And you can see the great power of God in the different things that he's doing. He gives them a lion, he gives them priests, he gives them prophets, he gives them guidance. There's a pillar of fire and a cloud, and you can see all of this, and there's a promise that he'll protect them. And they walk right into a land that they didn't have to buy. All they had to do was go in and take. And they've already got a house, and they've already got fields, and they already have crops planted. And so God says, I'm going to bring you in at exactly the right time. And what an incredible blessing that is. How great that is. But you realize what it does also. It divides. Because none of us would have gotten it. And that's the real issue, isn't it? God comes and he says, I'm going to be this great God that's going to bless these people. But it was Abraham and his family. It's not your family. In fact, he says, I don't have a law for you. I don't have any priests for you. I don't have any blessings for you. I don't have any land for you. I don't have anything for you. How's it going to be when Christmas comes and there's no present for you under the tree? Is that going to make you feel good? That's going to be pretty bad, isn't it? And so part of what God does, well, he's trying to bless one family and say, this is going to be a great thing, and all families will be blessed, not right now, but will be blessed, and it causes this division. And God says, these people are right. These are the people I like. These are the people I want to follow. And you would think that they would do great with God, that they would follow God, but they really don't. And so when you look at all of this, you realize that God gave them promises, but God made division. And that division continues, and we kind of make that division even worse. Because we have a whole lot of things that we allow to divide us. Things like race, and things like money, and education, and age, and politics. All of those things will not divide us, because, well, I want somebody to think I'm more important than you are. You want somebody to think you're more important. After all, you're younger, you're prettier, and we always do these things. We say, well, we're not like those people. Right? Or at least we see it going on. And God has done so much to bless Israel and so much to bring them through. He's given them the law at Sinai. And they should have been better people for it. I don't know that they were. You see, we're just sinners with no covenant and no promise and no blessings. But Jesus goes about fixing the problem. Not just saying, oh, it'll be okay. He goes about fixing the problem. You see, the problem that comes is a problem of sin. He says, let me fix that for you. The problem is a problem of law, because law is the thing that defines what sin is. And so, when law makes what sin is, then there's all kinds of things that become wrong. And he says, this is what you're supposed to do. And it divided people. people. It divided the chosen people of God from us, because we're not. And unless you are one of those who is an Israelite, we would be left out. We would not have that. So how can a law that's designed to help people be such a problem? Well, see, the law didn't bring any obedience. It didn't matter how much they post a speed limit. You realize most people are not obeying that. For some reason, it does not make people obey it. It lets you know what the guideline is, right? Don't go faster than this. Of course, it balances out. You can't go faster than that. There's too many people in the way. So you're safe there. But we get these laws and we think, oh, this will be good. People will do this. No, they won't. All the law does is define how wrong you are. You know, by how many miles over the speed limit you are, by how much is this going to cost, by, and there's all kinds of things that we have that way. And so there's this brokenness that comes in. Have you ever had something broken? Have you ever had broken an arm or a leg or something like that? Maybe you've broken a relationship before, and those are some of the hardest things to be able to heal when we have that kind of brokenness. We are broken, and we don't always function so well. Did you ever get blamed for something you didn't do? Or maybe you got blamed for something you did do. And either way, it's being blamed, and it doesn't feel good, right? It doesn't feel like you're doing what you're... It's just not a good feeling at all. And there's no one to forgive, because they're all broken, too. And we're all just pointing at each other, trying to blame each other. But Jesus heals arms. Jesus heals relationship. Because if you look at that passage that he's really talking about, in verse 12 or verse 13, he says, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who made us both into one, and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in the place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and he preached peace to you who were far off and peace to you who were near." What a tremendous passage. And yet it's said in words that we don't always grasp sometimes. When he talks about breaking down this dividing wall, he's talking about breaking down the law. He says, what if there were no speed limits? Could you be guilty of speeding? No. He says, all right, well, we're going to take that away. Only in here, not outside. When you get in your car to go home, be careful. But he says, we're going to take away those things. We're going to take away whatever was defined as wrong and whatever condemned you. You've been brought near by the blood of Christ, because Jesus was that sacrifice. He was that last sacrifice for us. And so we have a new covenant in him. We have been brought near by the blood of Christ, because he is that promised son of Abraham who was there to be able to be that blessing for all people. He was Messiah to the Jews. And promises were made about Gentiles, and he would come and fulfill those. And so then we have a part in this, because there were prophets who made promises about that. That if we believe in Jesus as being the Son of God and the things that he did on earth, that he was born on earth and that he died for our sins and that he paid the price for us, that we are able to go and to have this thing completely done. He breaks down this dividing wall. He breaks down this hostility. He makes us into a new person. He makes everybody who's divided into one new person. Because this breaking down of this wall, this abolishing of this law and commandments is really incredible. He fulfills it all so that it's no longer effective. He doesn't just smash it and say, oh, we're just not going to do it. He fulfills it all and says, let me give you something that is so much better, that is so much higher. And so as he is fulfilling this, you can see an illustration of this in Matthew 5, where he takes even some of the Ten Commandments. And it says things like, well, you've already said you will not murder. And I said you don't hate. Well, he's taking one of the Ten Commandments and saying, I'm changing it. And that's exactly what he did. He broke down the Ten Commandments and he says, those things are not valid anymore. But I'm going to give you a new covenant, a better covenant, one that you're able to deal with. And so he abolishes all of that. He takes it away because he has fulfilled it, and he breaks this Old Testament by fulfilling it all. He's the last sacrifice. He's the promise of fulfillment for all of the things that had been promised. And he didn't come to just Jews. He came to people with a faith like Abraham. He's the one that made peace. He made real peace among some of the things that divide us so much. He took away the reason for fear and prejudice and hate because he says, I'm going to make a new man. Maybe you've heard about the fires in California. Those don't bring peace, do they? But Jesus came to make peace. And when a fire starts, it starts burning out of control. What are we going to do about it? Well, the thing we're going to try and do is contain it, right? We're going to try and make sure that it stays within a certain boundary. We're going to, at least maybe you've got a helicopter or a plane that can drop something on it. It'll quench the fire. That's what Jesus does. He says, I break fire. How do you break fire? He says, I break fire. I am breaking down anything that would destroy you. Maybe that's an illustration you can get hold of because he just goes and he could just take it and go, this is not existing anymore. I'm going to break down this fire and in its place, I'm going to bring new life. Because what fire does is it destroys everything. And it makes it where it's not going to bloom anymore. But it does come back. And Jesus says, I am the one who is making real peace. Our idea is just to control the fire. He says, no, I'm not doing that. I'm breaking it all down. And so we are new people. We are not hyphen Christians anymore. I don't know if you realize what those are. We're white Christians, or we're rich Christians, or we're educated Christians, as opposed to being Hispanic or poor or uneducated. It's not about racial equality or gender equality anymore. It says we were humans until race disconnected us, religion separated us, politics divided us, and wealth classified us. And Jesus breaks every single one of those things down. What we have done, the best we have done, is say, well, let's have equality. And so we will try to have racial equality. We will try to have gender equality. You realize Jesus is not for equality at all. He is not trying to make racial equality. He is not trying to make gender equality or education equality. He is not for equality at all. He's asking you to give up your advantage, whatever advantage you think that is. And he says, I'm going to make a new person. And so all of those people who are divided, he takes them and makes them new people in Christ. He makes them Christians. And he says, well, because you're new people in Christ, you no longer have any division between you. And it's not about being equal to anything or anybody because I've taken all of that away and I've broken it down. And it's no longer part of where you are. He's asking us to give up your race. He's asking you to give up whether you're young or old. He's asking you to give up the money. To give up the idea that I've got more than everybody else. I saw this cartoon. That 1% controls 46% of the world's wealth. Of course, the little guy says, well, it's still not enough. We're not even half. Should that exist in church? Absolutely not. Absolutely not, because Jesus has broken down all of those things, making a new man that goes beyond race, beyond gender. In fact, as you look at Scripture, you're able to see that we used to know Christ. I mean, they physically used to know Christ. We saw him. We know what kind of hair he had. We know what his eyes were like. We know he was nothing like the pictures. Because he looks pretty. He looks pretty. That's what all the pictures are. He just looks pretty. But in 2 Corinthians 5:16, he says, we don't recognize him that way anymore. We recognize a spiritual person. We recognize a Savior. Because it goes beyond race or gender or education. We are new in Christ. And we don't even use those physical things anymore. Sometimes we get stuck in our own argument and say, well, I've got to have equality. I've got to have more rights. Then you won't have Jesus. Because you give up all of those in order to be this new person in Christ who has no one to be different from him, who is the same with everybody else, and he builds them all into this one new place. And he goes on to describe that place in Ephesians 2. In verse 18, he says, For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of apostles and prophets, Christ himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place of God by the Spirit. And we can do that because we don't have any of those things that we've declared as advantage before. We don't have any of those things that we thought were a disadvantage before. It's because Jesus has made us all one in Christ. He has broken down every barrier, every dividing wall, including Old Testament itself. And he says, I've taken all that away. I fulfill all of that. And what matters that you're a new person in Christ. And I'm going to take that new person in Christ and I'm going to give all of you access through this Holy Spirit to God. And not only that, but I'm going to build you into this new place together. Because you are joined. You are community. You are citizens. You are saints. You are members who are built together into this new place where we all have one place with each other. And it doesn't matter about the cracks. The structure and joined grows into a temple of God. We are built together in the Spirit to be a dwelling place of God where he lives. Can there be something better than that? I don't think there can be anything greater than that. So where I would give up that just to have what? My race? Money? My education? Well, yeah, I want to think I'm smarter than everybody else. You're not going to be smarter than everybody else. Because the wisdom of God is so further beyond what you're thinking. And that's the wisdom that we have. We usually emphasize a very particular part, but, you know, God joins together people who have given up all of those advantages for Christ. He took away law by fulfilling it. And he brings this new law, this new covenant of God. And this group that he has now is a spiritual house. And it only happens to people who have been broken. It only happens to people who realize that they can't have that advantage anymore. See, we're all sinners and we need the forgiveness of Christ. Look at the end of Galatians chapter 3. This is the last passage. He says, now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then the law was our guardian until Christ came in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. What a tremendous passage. As he talks about this time, he says, you realize that there was a time before faith came, which is an odd thing. before the explanation of how faith could bring us to God. There were some people who had faith, but it was before the explanation of how believing in God and in His Son Jesus Christ was able to make us part of this. He says there was a time before that. There was a time when you were divided. There was a time when there was Jew and Gentile. And there was a time when that we were split. We were divided. But now that faith has come, you're no longer under those systems. You're no longer under a guardian like that. We are now sons of God through faith. And the expression of that faith is that we use that by being baptized into Christ and making this new covenant. Because that's the response of faith, is this baptism into Christ. And so it makes a new covenant. It makes new people, no longer people who are just there because of race or gender or any of those things that would divide us. I still see people using this passage to say, well, this is about equality. This passage has nothing to do with equality. This passage is about people who have given up all equality in order to just be Christian, just be God's people. He says none of that matters anymore because he's talking here about salvation. He's not talking about order or worship or anything else. He's talking about salvation. And as you look at the passage and look at what he's trying to do, he says, these were things in the way you classified yourself. But now we are Christians together. We are built together. And if you allow that, then you are Abraham's offspring. Then you go in. You have this promise that is being fulfilled through him. Because we put on Christ. No longer Jews or Greeks or slaves or free or anybody with gender issues. We are Christians. We are superseding any of those other things. And we have those blessings in God. We have the blessings of Christ. We have the promises because those were put in place long, long before. So let me just ask you today, do you believe in Jesus as the Son of God? Do you think he's someone who's able to heal the brokenness that you see in your life and in people around you? You know, he makes a huge difference. Have you made the action that it will take to give up all those things that you would say, oh, I'm this and I'm that, to be able to live in his life, to be able to live for him? If you haven't done that, let's do that this morning. If you have done that, sing extra loud on this song. Let's stand and sing.